tell us about rotation in general? Rotation is the most intriguing motion because it can last forever. And second, rotation with respect to what? That has been a problem since Newton with his famous bucket. And as far as I understand, this is still not quite resolved.
Though we produce lots of buckets.
Good morning. I will talk about rotations in general relativity. And let me begin with names of my collaborators. I shall name them later, but it's better if I do it before, just not to forget about them. These are Dr. Patrick Mach, Dr. Michał.
Mach, of course, when it comes to rotations.
This is Stichmachu.
He claims to be related somehow. He says that there's a distant relationship to this Mach from Vienna. I'm not sure that this is true. Michał Piruk, Dr. Michał Piruk, and a student of the fourth year, Knopik. And also Professor Jaranowski.
He's a graduate to get the first Knopik.
Jerzy. Jerzy. And Piotr, Professor Piotr Jaranowski, who was an early stage of the work involved. And I would like to show you, I shall derive new general relativistic predictions, small general relativistic effects which should appear in self-gravitating massive systems. The frame dragging general relativity is something which is well known. Do you have a pointer?
Yes,
yes,
it's
there. So imagine that this is a space-time. This space-time is rotating. There is a curved black hole. This is an artist's vision. So this is the rotation axis. And the space-time rotates, and then anybody that falls in will be dragged by the rotating space-time. So it will rotate around the center. This effect will be tiny, small, far from the center, and that will be very strong, close to the ergosphere, when the rotation, linear rotation speed will be equal to the speed of light. So this is a relatively well-known effect, and known from a very long period. But I would like to describe a situation in which we have heavy fluids. They self-gravitate. In this case, we don't have a compact formula for the metric of the space-time. The self-gravity matters, and that will have some effects that I show you later. And there are some possible applications in astrophysics. Astrophysics usually lag far behind general relativists. The best example is that Einstein derived the redshift formula in 1907. The first experimental verification of that formula took place in 1961, the Kripke experiment in Princeton. But astrophysicists used redshift only in 1970s, 1980s. So astrophysicists need a lot of time. So I'm not saying that this prediction that I shall show you in a moment that will be used by astrophysicists immediately, but maybe in the 60, 70 years perspective that cannot be excluded. In order to derive those effects, Patrick Mach and myself we had to overcome a difficulty. Namely, people didn't know how to specify stationary rotating systems in general physiodynamics. A new rotation law had to be invented, and this is one also.
Invented or discovered?
I think discovered. It does exist in nature, but somehow it had to be discovered. I am not creating the universe, so it's
so fun.
Just to compare, I would like to describe the Newtonian hydrodynamics just to have the reference point and to know that we have generalistic weak field effects, that we should know which is the base from which those effects can be counted. So a few words about Newtonian hydrodynamics. Assume polytropic gases which rotate around a fixed axis. The rotation axis is fixed, so this is the rotation axis, and there is a gas rotating around that. That gas could be in the form of a star, or it could be in the form of a disk rotating around a central mass. If this polytropic equation of state with the quadratic index gamma, then one can easily find specific enthalpy by this formula. And if we assume axial symmetry, then you have only the stationary Euler equations, and you have the Poisson equation. So this is the...
And this expression for enthalpy is independent from the rotation. It's for the polytropic.
It's independent from the rotation.
This is then one has the specific, I mean, the sentence is incorrect. The enthalpy is not related to the rotation.
Then one has specific enthalpy, and this is related to the equation state. Sorry for the jump, but in the sentence, but this is what I meant.
Then in any way is a confusing expression, because for there is a problem what is meant by the entropy for polytropic gases if they don't have a temperature. There is no temperature, I mean, you are missing one intensive variable.
This entropy is related to the speed of sound. And astrophysicists tend to identify the speed of sound with
the speed of sound is just the derivative of pressure with respect to density.
Yeah.
Astrophysicists
tend to identify the speed of sound with the thermal velocity, and then
the question is the entropy will be relevant for further analysis?
No, that's not relevant.
Entropy is assumed to be constant.
This specific enthalpy is important because those Euler equations they simplify. The right hand side, this material part, can be written as a full gradient of a scalar quantity. So this is Newtonian hydrodynamics, axial symmetry, not those three equations, and this is a nonlinear system which is undetermined. In order to solve it, one has to prescribe Delph's velocity, that's the angular velocity, omega naught. So there is a freedom, but that freedom is not.
That is just given the frequency. What do you mean by this?
It is prescribed arbitrarily.
For every omega, you can solve them.
Not quite for every omega. I am going to write down a condition that omega has to satisfy.
Omega
is a function of the
coordinates. Is a function of coordinates, but not of all coordinates, but only on the distance from the rotation axis. So that's the condition. omega not
eight and not
does not depend on z.
Omega depends only on the distance from the rotation axis. That's the only condition. Otherwise, one can find any rotation curve. Well, not quite the so-called stability condition, which is not quite sufficient stability condition. But let me not discuss this here. There is a wide possibility. There are many possibilities of finding that rotation curve that is the dependence of the angular velocity on the distance from the rotation curve. Now, if we choose this monomial form of the angular velocity,
but what happens to the continuity equation? The omega is just the rotation of the velocity.
The continuity equation, we have asymmetry, we have special rotation, is satisfied identically.
Yeah, but this is still Newtonian mechanics, so it is a divergence of a density times velocity.
It is satisfied identically. It holds true, it is satisfied identically. So this is why I'm not talking about it.
So what is delta?
Delta is a number. W is also a number. Now, this rotation curve...
Delta is a number.
But somehow related to the properties of the...
Say delta equal minus 1 over 3, I think. That gives omega naught equal to W naught divided by R to the 3 over 4, over 2. I think this okay. And that's essentially Keplerian rotation. If delta is minus 1, that's the case that I shall discuss at the end of my talk, then omega naught is equal to 1 over r, and the linear velocity is constant. The linear velocity v is constant.
Yeah, but this is just a very specific situation.
But that will be important from a point. If delta is minus infinity, then there's again important situation. This angular velocity is constant. Omega. Is it right? Yes. It's constant. So these are the special cases.
But delta must somehow be related to the physical properties of this system.
This is true.
Because it enters the equation. That's what I ask about the equation of state. Or the
No, delta is not related to the equation. It's independent.
But the continuity equation would depend on because the velocity equation, the velocity field, enters the continuity equation and the density, so they are related.
The continuity equation, we have stationary t, we have
rho times
u.
Well, okay, call it u.
But u has only phi component. And the system is exactly symmetric, so this is identity zero.
But nevertheless, the rho and u are related. That's equal to zero, but you can calculate this divergence and you will get the equation divergence.
Mathematically fulfilled because of the symmetry.
The symmetry assumption, yes.
No, because there will be one derivative of u times rho.
First of all, there's one much more specific question that will be in a moment. I shall say in a moment. So, these are Newtonian equations describing Newtonian hydrodynamics. We have possibility to choose in almost arbitrary way that angular velocity. And then we have an algebraic equation. It's not quite algebraic. This enthalpy, specific enthalpy. This is the potential actually is a functional. So this is an algebraic functional, algebraic integral equation. And this is nonlinear. This is nonlinear. We should supplement that equation but by the Newton, by the Poisson equation. Now, this system, this is a very interesting system because this is a free boundary problem. We cannot specify ahead of time the shape of the solution. The shape of the solution comes with the solution. There are some exceptions. For instance, if we have dust, then dust must be located on a plane, and then at least we know that disk is located on a plane, but still we have the freedom to choose the inner and outer boundary. This is a very interesting situation, a free boundary problem, and so there's the image, artistic image of that. We don't know the internal boundary of that, we don't know the external boundary, we don't know the shape in three dimensions, and there is no mathematics that deals with this. This is an open question for mathematics to find, say, existence criteria for solution and so on. Well, in practice, this is what people do, they solve the problem numerically and they can assume, for instance, a particular ratio between the central mass, if we have in mind the rotation of a disk around the central mass. So one can specify the ratio of the disk mass, central mass, and one can specify the ratio of the...
But this density shown on the plot does not seem to be axially symmetric, that's right.
Yeah. Well, that's artistic vision. That's artistic vision.
Artistic vision of another problem, eventually.
It's not quite, it is almost. Forget about deviations from intersymmetry.
So there is some nice picture.
There is a nice picture. So let me summarize what we know from... how much time do you have? That's important. 11.
An hour.
Okay. Okay. From Newtonian hydrodynamics, we have an arbitrariness. We can choose the rotation curve, the angular velocity, as an arbitrary function of the distance from the rotation axis. And the mathematics is interesting because this is a free boundary problem. The shape of a solution comes with the solution itself. Now, let us go to generality. This is either a symmetric line element, which allows for self-gravitation. We are not talking about any specific solution. We don't talk about a black hole. We allow general space-times generated by rotating fluids. Equation of say is the same before. Again, I assume that rotation is around a fixed axis. I assume axial symmetry. And the velocity of particles of fluids in which almost all components, with the exception of the zero component and the component in direction of the phi, a coordinate, and the angular velocity omega is the ratio of u phi divided by u naught. That should be u naught instead of u naught. The sense energy tensor, which describes this perfect fluid, is something that you see here, and there is also the continuity equation, which again is satisfied.
There is some unit of length assumed here.
U mu is minus one. The length of the four velocity is minus one.
But no, this is choosing the speed of light as a unit, but the components of u.
The components of u, they are, if c is one, then they are equal to minus one. U mu is minus one. If the speed of light is non-zero, then I think that's the right way to say.
But omega enters into mu, 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 mu.
This is true. This is true. Yeah. But that's condition.
So, so ut is related to omega.
Ut is related to omega, yeah. And that's the way how it is related. That part of my talk is essentially known. It is not well known, but it was discussed by a group of astrophysicists and generativists from Japan about 25 years ago. So they wrote down equations and just displaying almost all of them. These are the only equations that do matter for myself, because I am interested in small field effects. And there's complicated equations. There are some functions which are displayed here. V is something like a linear velocity of a particle of gas. So that is omega minus a phi over r squared c squared. Remember I told you at the very beginning that a rotating black hole drags particles of fluid. So this is represented, this minus is exactly the situation. We have this angular velocity, and since there is dragging, then the effective velocity with respect to the inertial system, which is being dragged by the rotating space-time, is this.
So there is also some unit of time assumed here.
There is some unit of time. Now I'm going to the metric. There's the X naught is my time, you see is included. So that's the metric coefficient.
No, that I understand, but in your formula for the velocity, it's omega next.
In the formula of the velocity,
yes, you have r squared times omega instead of omega squared would be.
No, omega
squared.
Square.
No, square.
Square. There's a square of the.
There is a square. There's
so
a square.
R, yeah.
Okay. Again, as before, that is in an analogous way, there's some freedom. But this time, this freedom, this arbitrariness is on a different level. Before, we had right to choose the angular velocity in a way that we wish to do. The only condition that emerged from the equation was that omega could depend only on the disorientation axis. Now, this freedom emerges on the level of the angular momentum density, angular momentum per unit mass. And this is an observation which is due to Berlin, Wagoner, and other people, and it dates 1971-1972. So there's some arbitrariness. This arbitrariness now it consists in the possibility of choosing J as any function of the angular velocity omega. And then that should be inserted here, the chosen function of omega. Then you have a linear equation for omega. And one can try to solve the equation with respect to omega and get angular velocity as a function of coordinates. Quite complicated. But this is how it should be. And this, so there is an arbitrariness, but this arbitrariness has only this form. We can choose J, the angular momentum per unit mass, as arbitrary function of angular velocity, but J cannot depend on anything else. It can depend only on angular velocity.
So angular momentum is independent on the position?
Angular momentum, eventually, it depends on the position, but in a convoluted way. It depends on position through angular velocity. So we assume that J is a function of.
So you postulate some function J of omega.
I postulate some function of
omega. For example, J of omega is equal to omega times constant.
This is, you can do, you can
and
do
then
this.
You will have a quadratic equation for omega. So
yeah.
And then because omega might be arbitrary function of r, then backwards the angular momentum depends
exactly.
on r.
Exactly.
Is that exactly the explanation?
That's the explanation.
Yeah. It depends on r only through omega.
Mm-hmm. Only through the omega. The r dependence of J comes. Only through the omega, that's important the, assumption is, of the J of omega.
Yeah, that's exactly
that there
the
is nothing else in J, right? Yeah. That it cannot be omega times R or whatever, it must be just omega.
And in this case, those general relativistic Euler equations can be reduced to the Bernoulli equation, which is similar to this algebraic equation that I showed you before.
But physically, is this sensible? I mean, the angular momentum is. I said it's proportional to the omega, but I mean, if I will say J is equal to omega to the
60. Your choice is the canonical choice.
Because that's the only one which can think physically, right? Otherwise, you can have a. How J can be say omega to the square? What kind of a physical process?
That's one of the main points of my talk to write down this function in your
omega. Okay, sorry.
This is why I am here. In this case, the situation is somewhat more complicated. I don't write those. Okay, we have, since I am interested in weak solutions, weakly deviating from flat space-time or Minkowski space-time, then those three equations are sufficient. I should keep only
terms. There is a plus sign in the second line?
Plus this expression.
But where is the equation? The equation is
upstairs.
At the very beginning.
This is the.
That's the equation.
So there are three equations.
There are three equations, okay. And there are three analytic equations. One, two, three.
And there's an algebraic
Bernoulli equation, which is displayed somewhat later for a particular choice of the angular momentum. So this is again an algebraic functional equation, and we have three analytic equations.
And where does the Bernoulli equation come from?
You just put that from Gantian analytics.
I see.
The Gantian analytics.
The result of Einstein
equation. Yeah, these are the function equations. So we have three nonlinear analytic equations, and we have a functional algebraic Bernoulli equation, and they have to be solved. And again, this is a free-bodied problem. This is exactly as Newtonian hydrodynamics. The solution, the shape of the solutions comes with the solution. And again, there is no mathematics. It's an open problem for mathematicians. Which I think they know for a long time, but we don't know what to do. Now, let me describe what people did before when choosing angular momentum as a function of omega, because it was still very close. People chose a linear formula for the angular momentum. Omega multiplied by a constant plus another constant. So this is what they did. The problem is that that should be inserted here to the left hand side.
But if this constant is there, then even for zero angular velocity, still have angular momentum.
Where does it come from? We have
negative.
The angular momentum can be carried only by particles of fluid. So if J changes time, you can say the fluid stops.
But angular momentum is still there.
The continuous angular momentum at the end of fluid. This is.
No, if there's no rotation?
There is a rotation. No, sorry. Okay, so you have to avoid the situation. J equal constant is perfect. Correct.
Where does it come from? The angular momentum without rotation?
No, there is a rotation. If we go to the Newtonian limit, it's better to understand when we do the passing to the Newtonian limit. In the Newtonian limit, J is essentially R squared multiplied by omega, is it right?
Yes. Yes.
And if omega is 1 over R squared, then we have constant angular momentum, constant density of the angular momentum. If omega is 1 over R squared, then J...
But if omega is 0, then J is 0.
If omega is 0, then it's 0. But I address the doubt raised by Professor Kionishi Bidula, and I'm saying that constant angular momentum could make sense.
Yes, true. Is this zero?
In other words, omega is not what we are used to understand.
If you have a fluid, right? This fluid is not in the cup. Okay, this comes from this free boundary problem. If you can rotate the whole infinite liquid, and this is irrelevant physically, because this whole rotation of the liquid as a whole universe filled with the liquid.
Omega equals you have to exclude omega equals zero by definition. You have to exclude omega equals zero.
This is but my question is what happens if omega is equal to
think about very tiny omega.
That's what I'm discussing.
This is discovered in 1971, that is was a simple choice, but I am not enthusiast of this choice, let me say, and now I shall explain why.
C is time dependent, now it's zero.
If we assume that form of J, put it here, and solve, we have then an only equation for the angular velocity omega. Find omega from that equation, that omega will depend on all coordinates. And now do the Newtonian limit, go with C to infinity. And then you discover that this does not give, for instance, the Keplerian rotation. This law does not give the Keplerian rotation. But it gives the uniform rotation in which omega is constant.
What do you mean by Keplerian rotation?
Keplerian rotation is a convention that we know from solar system, 1 over r to the 4 over 2.
Oh, that's that, okay.
Yeah. So Keplerian rotation does not follow from that expression.
But what is the physical motivation for this assumption, J equals A minus C?
Because the physical motivation, No, there are two important cases that can be included. One case is that, assume that A is very big, that omega should be close to C. Rotation is uniform, or almost uniform. And this is a relevant physical system. You cannot exclude rotations which are uniform. For instance, people in Jena, they even developed philosophy that in general relativity, the only rotation is allowed is a uniform rotation. This philosopher, I'm sure, is wrong, but nevertheless, there are people who believe in uniform rotation. So this includes uniform rotation, omega equal constant.
But that I would argue that if it's uniform rotation, I was thinking about, then the energy of the rotation is infinite.
The energy, now you have a finite disk of gas.
You cannot have it physically.
Gravity. There's gravity and there's a free boundary system. You can't.
So where is the gravitation field in this expression?
The gravitational field is. These are those three elliptic equations.
In Einstein equations.
In Einstein equations.
Ah. Very nice.
Yeah, but in this expression for J, it should be U somewhere. If it has to depend on the gravity.
V right? depends on the metric. This is metric coefficient.
Okay, so the A, I'm sorry.
So this is
there are so many coefficients that we are not trained. You start to miss the.
This is the relativity after all.
Yeah,
but I hope that this, the essence of what can be done is clear. So.
Anyhow, but will you be using this formula for J with C?
No, I will use another formula. Okay. So this formula is not good. This formula
we agree that it's no good.
This formula is not good because it gives
for various reasons
uniform rotation. Astrophysicists are quite happy with that, and they are, I would say, even addicted to the uniform rotation. Very simple, it allows simple integration. There was Japanese relativist that I mentioned before. They worked with that rotation law, and they loved uniform rotation. And there is slightly more sophisticated rotation law. Yoshida and Yoriguchi, they were those two Japanese relativists who had been studying that 25 years ago. But a few years ago, they again returned to this topic and they formulated another rotation law, which again is not very good.
Because there is no universal law. Therefore, every such a choice is just an ansatz and may be motivated by analysis of a physical situation,
We would like, for instance, to have a model which gives the right Newtonian limit. I think this is a reasonable condition. And none of those conditions, with the exception of the uniform rotation, does give the right Newtonian limit. For instance,
I have no focus idea whether this is correct or not, but isn't that the choice of J determines the shape of this? Because it's, I'm still thinking about this free boundary.
This is true. This is true.
That it comes because in various classical hydrodynamic problems, when we are asking about the shape of the fluid, right? We also have no free boundary problem. The Stefan problem is like this, and then making an assumption about the equation of state, which in this case is corresponding, I believe, to this equation, you get different shapes
of
this. Is this possible that this assumption of this gentleman from Japan is related that they want to get a special shape of this fluid?
No, certainly not, because for a given J, I can have infinite number of shapes. And my colleagues.
Maybe a family of shapes which is numerated by some of this C or alpha. I don't know.
Well, that might happen, but that's. I don't think that's.
Okay.
Shape. In order to specify shape, one needs additional information. For instance, one should give a rough description of the geometry. For instance, one can give the width of a disk and its height.
I don't know how it's in general relativity, but in the normal
In Newtonian,
it will be trivial. Okay. Shape is determined by the function of rho. You plot the rho as a function of r, and that's the shape.
But we'll discuss later. It's not a
simple. No, it's okay. Yeah.
It's not a simple. Anyway, those attempts in the past, they didn't give the right Newtonian limit, and we were not able to get the Newtonian rotation in the Newtonian limit. So this is what I'm underlying, that in particular, one wouldn't get if the player rotation with delta equal minus 1 over 3. Okay. So that's the new rotation law. J of omega is this object. There is a parameter W. There is a parameter delta and kappa. There is a normalization condition. The condition is that dust, which is test dust, does not carry mass, moves in the Schwarzschild geometry on circles. We know that in the Schwarzschild geometry we can have orbits which are circles, and the standard Kepler law holds true. So we demand that for the dust which is massless, the same is true, and that specifies this condition kappa, that kappa is given up to 1 over c squared by
that. What peculiar happens when delta is equal to 1/3? By 0.
Minus 1/3. Delta cannot be positive.
Delta 1/3.
Delta cannot be
minus 3 delta is equal to 0, then.
If delta is bigger than 0, there is a condition which astrophysicists call, say, is a stability condition, and this stability is broken. That stability condition means that essentially angular momentum should be carried far from the center.
Is there some simple motivation for this very complicated form of J of omega?
Yes, there are two. One, I described before the moment, that the massless dust satisfies identically Einstein hydrodynamic equations. Okay. And the second is that I should have the Newtonian limit, the right Newtonian limit. In particular, I should get the Keplerian rotation. And this is what
happens. What is massless dust?
A bunch of test particles orbiting around.
But test particles have a mass. If they don't have a mass, small, then they are photons.
Test particles don't have mass.
Well, you may.
So think how do they enter the gravitational equation?
Like photons. They move along geodesics, but they do not gravitate.
So
I'm sorry for the question, but here on the Earth,
that's fine. That's the rotation law.
Yes, unfortunately.
And that's the rotation law, and from this equation, one can find omega as function of coordinates. So this is a complicated system because we have the rotation law, we solve equations, we insert a solution to this equation into the rotation law, then we find out the angular velocity. But in the case of Newtonian limit, this is relatively simple. That's the answer. And in the Newtonian limit, we have this expression, and therefore we can have the Keplerian rotation, delta not equal to minus 1 over 3. We can have linear rotation, delta not equal minus 1. We can have uniform rotation, delta not equal minus infinity, that omega not is constant. So this condition, which I said at the beginning, that I should have the right Newtonian limit, is satisfied. Now, let us go to the next order. Now, first, there's a minor lemma. This is a theoretical talk, which is one lemma formulated. This lemma tells us that if delta is minus 1 over 3, then from the formula that was written for kappa before, kappa is 3, and psi, the function psi, can be interpreted as the binding energy of fluid. And there's here the binding energy of dust, of massless dust, of test dust is of course 0. So this lemma says that weightless disk of dust satisfies analytic Pythagorean initial equations, and this is proved simply by insertion into the equations. There is nothing particularly interesting. Now, assuming a situation in which we have a disk of fluid which rotates around a black hole. And this black hole will be imitated by a perturbation of the Schwarzschild black hole. If this function u d is zero, it enters here, and if function a phi is zero, then please believe me that this is just the Schwarzschild metric, but in the so-called conformal coordinates. So I am taking perturbed Schwarzschild metric in this particular form. I am taking the rotation law. Now there's a question of calculations and doing the first post-Newtonian approximation. I shall split all quantities, for instance the angular velocity, into the Newtonian velocity plus the 1pm counterpart, the part proportional to 1 over c squared. The same with density, the same with entropy, potential, and so on. Then it emerges that one of the metric functions, that metric function which is responsible for dragging, this function a phi is responsible for the dragging. This function satisfies an elliptic equation of this form. And what's important, there are corrections to the Newtonian angular velocity. Omega, the angular velocity in this perturbed system, this deformed Schwarzschild system, is the Newtonian angular velocity, which is this, that's the monomial angular velocity, in particular that could be the Keplerian angular velocity, plus three corrections. And one correction is well known, that a phi is a function which is responsible for dragging. And this is almost dragging, not quite. That would be dragging if delta is zero. But remember that our disk of gas, it has to make the space-time rotating. So the dragging, the function a phi, cannot give the same dragging as, say, in the Kerr geometry. There's some delay. There's this story about Murphy, who tried to jump over a fence by pushing through his car. There's a similar situation. You have a rotating fluid. That rotating fluid makes the space-time to rotate, and that rotating space-time pushes somehow forward the particles of fluid. And that's the, this is what this term does. That's the standard dragging formula. But there are two other formulae, and this is really interesting stuff that I would like to tell you about. This term is important only inside matter, inside gas, because the enthalpy, the specific enthalpy, is non-zero only in the regions where we have matter. Now, this is a question of doing some small mathematics, and that was done in a paper with Piotr Janowski, Patrick Mach, and Michal Piruk in Physica, in this year. One can show
that this dragging term has a different sign from this material term. Those two terms act against each other. So we can say that this term represents anti-dragging. In self-gravitating rotating systems with matter, matter can work against dragging. There is another phenomenon, and this phenomenon, I show you in a moment, the result of numerical calculation, can be stronger than dragging itself. So you see one new weak field effect, anti-dragging. If you don't know what to remember from this seminar, that please remember the word anti-dragging. Let me comment, maybe not only on that formula, but also on the rest. So, in the weak field approximation, the angular, the Newtonian angular velocity is supplemented by those three terms: dragging, anti-dragging, and another one that I will talk in a moment.
What is the dependence of H naught on R?
It comes from numerics. I cannot say. This is
so. In general, these terms.
This is
differently depending on the value of R.
So H is zero on the boundary and is maximal somewhere here. So it is decreasing. It's difficult to say anything, but what we can say that H naught is positive, the same minus or this is negative.
Yes, but if the dependence on R is completely different.
It's different, yeah. It's different. There is no easy way to do analytic description. But please notice following fact. If delta is minus infinity, that's the uniform rotation. Uniform rotation corresponds to the delta minus infinity. Those corrections cancel. They become equal to zero. And those Japanese.
Everything is zero then.
This is constant. This is constant. One over infinity is zero, r to zero is one. Let us make this crude approximation. R to zero is one. So, for the uniform rotation, all those corrections do vanish. There are no weak field effects for the uniform rotation. And remember that those Japanese relativists that they investigated that subject about 20 years ago, they assumed uniform rotation. So they didn't have even a chance to obtain those weak field corrections. The same I can say about Jena Piccolo, Meinl and Neugebauer, because they also prefer uniform rotation. Now, this is a result of one of hundreds of numerical calculations. We have a small supercomputer in Krakow, which is dedicated for hydrodynamic calculations, and it's very good to do that. So this is one of hundreds calculations. In this part, anti-dragging is stronger than dragging. In this part, outside this blue region, the dragging dominates. And also please notice that those results, they are tinier, of the order of half of a percent of the, these are normalized results, so this is what you see here. What you see here is a normalized angular velocity, normalized to the versus the Newtonian.
What is on the vertical axis?
On the vertical, these are arbitrary. We just keep scale. So in this axis, is a normalized distance. This is a distance divided by the largest size of the system. And then the vertical line is in proportion from what comes from the operation. So, swamp?
What?
So, for instance, here 0.4, that means that the length, the vertical, the height in here is the same as the distance from here to here. The vertical line has the same scale as the horizontal line. There is a black hole in the center,
yes,
and this is the upper half of
the
disk.
So this is the shape of the...
This is the shape of the disk.
Of the distance.
Yeah.
This R, this is Z.
This is normalized Z, this is normalized R. That's the upper half of the disk, the lower half of the disk is exactly the same. And here is a region dominated by anthropic lighting, here is a region dominated by the lighting.
And what happens on the boundary between these two regions? Is there a smooth transition or what happens?
Of course there's a smooth transition because we search only smooth solutions, so certainly there's a smooth transition. And in this region, the weak correction, the 1/c² correction.
For example, the velocity of sound on this boundary?
Here, the velocity, we try the velocity of sound be relatively small, it's probably 10⁻³.
Yeah, but there is no change when you come from one region, blue region, to the yellow region?
No dramatic change. No dramatic change. We have polytropic equation of state. We don't allow for the formation of shocks. That would be too difficult. So we assume the entropy is constant. We assume everything is
constant. The only thing that happens is that one correction to the angular velocity becomes larger than another. That's the difference.
Now, there is yet another term, the last one. This one that I should explain. And this, if we have a point-like particle.
I'm terribly sorry, but on this, I'm too slow.
Okay.
On this region between blue and yellow, right, when it comes, the one is entirely dragging, the other is dragging.
Yeah.
So I cannot envisage this as that there is a part of a fluid which goes that way and the other goes this way.
Why? This is actually quite a difficult situation. The uniform rotation actually is an exception. Always, if you assume differential law of rotation, that's always the case that different shares of fluid move slightly differently. So this.
Yeah, but they don't change direction.
No, this Newtonian term is anyway dominating. These are small corrections.
But if I would subtract,
but why subtract? Newtonian is dominating.
He's asking for the sign of the correction.
Sign of the correction that on the one side of this boundary it is that way and the other is
that way. Maybe it's better to say in terms of the period of rotation. The period of rotation in this yellow part is shorter due to this relativistic correction. In this blue part, the period of rotation is longer. Fluid needs a little bit longer time to return to the original position. So
if that was the real fluid, there would be a frictional force there.
No friction here.
I know there is no friction.
There is no friction.
But if you have a region where the velocity, then it's obvious that this is unphysical because there is always a friction.
you now present the Jena point of view.
It's a 100% Warsaw.
This is, but I heard that from them before. Let me say, nature just contradicts that. As of it is now objects, many objects in which we see capillary rotation. Capillary rotation is a differential rotation with the same argument that you told before. It applies perfectly well. So absolutely, nature is against that point of view. Okay, so there's this term which I say self-gravity term. I should say self-fluid self-gravity term.
And where is the gravitational constant?
The gravitational constant is in U naught. In U naught. And now, in the Keplerian limit, there's this omega squared R equals Gm. I think I should. Omega squared R squared equals Gm, I think. And if we have a test fluid, then for the Newtonian potential, this is zero. If the fluid is self-gravitating, is contributing to the gravity, then this term is non-zero. So this is the justification of the name of the self-gravity term. And this self-gravity term can be actually bigger than dragging and anti-dragging. And here is a result of another calculation. It's a different calculation than before. This is blue. This is this self-gravity term. That's the anti-Keplerian term, and that's the dragging term. The dragging and anti-dragging, they can cancel. But nevertheless, there will be net effect due to the self-gravity, which works in the same direction as dragging. All three effects can be noticed. And that's again the same picture, but combined. That's the dragging term. This is what people knew for a long time. And that's the effect in which we take into account both anti-dragging and self-gravity. And actually, this dragging can be even more pronounced than in the case of purely geometric. Now, let me go briefly, 1 minute, that's probably enough. To say about Asovitz gravitations. The so-called Bardeen-Patterson effect, the Bardeen-Patterson effect, it referred to the standard dragging effect in a curved geometry. And if we assume that there is a rotation axis and the fluid rotates on a plane which is not orthogonal to the rotation axis, but it's under a small angle, then there will be a deformation of a disk. The disk should be deformed. This is called Bardeen-Patterson effect, which they described in about 1971 or 1972. And astrophysicists found an object which has this name, which, according to some of them, exemplifies the Bardeen-Patterson effect. There's still some debate going on, so let me say that the standard dragging on frame effect can be seen or may be seen in astrophysics by astrophysicists. Now, if that disk is self-gravitating, if its mass is large and contribution to the overall gravity is big, then this picture would again be changed by those two other effects that I told you before, by anti-dragging and the self-gravity effect. This can be relevant
in the description of Galicianai waveforms in this investigation that is going on, when people discuss gluing of a neutron star and a black hole of two neutron stars, then they could be created very compact systems, so compact that that would have some influence onto the rotation periods of the kind that they described. Milky Way. If Milky Way gets contracted by a factor of 1,000, then those generalistic effects would become important.
Event which is not likely to happen.
Which is not likely to happen, but nevertheless,
so
it's nice to see
the future.
It's nice to know that this is only a question of factor of 1,000. Now, yet another effect, and there's some astrophysical evidence. May I ask you to put light on? So, imagine that you have a black hole, there's a rotation axis, there's a rotating fluid, it goes in this direction. So, if there is an observer, then observer would see light rays. Say there's a linear velocity v, there's a linear velocity, maybe the observer should look here. The observer would see the same radiation, say the same kind of hydrogen line, red shifted or blue shifted. In this case, it would be blue shifted by a quantity related to v. In this case, it would be red shifted. Now, in the Newtonian description, and let me now come back to the linear velocity case. In the Newtonian description, for the linear velocity, delta equal minus one, for the constant linear velocity, imagine that there exists such an object in the universe. The observer would see that there's a jump, just through the center. There will be blue shift here. So if that's omega, there's the original line. The original line frequency will go up. And there will be a red shift in the other way. And the picture will be sharp. Lines will be sharp. That's the situation in the internal description. In general, the situation is different because those one of the C squared corrections, they depend on the height z given the distance. And that means that there will be a widening. Exactly. There will be widening. So there's a clear distinction between Newtonian and general relativistic prediction. There are objects which are similar in a sense to NGC 4258. NGC 4258, maybe that will be of interest for people working in optics. This is an example of a supernumerizer. This is a fluid, there's a rotating disk in which there are dozens of hundreds of supermasers, and the supermasers, they send from time to time radiation, and that allows to describe very accurately the geometry of the system. And people know, for instance, that the rotation of the system is Keplerian. This is exactly Keplerian. But there are similar systems with supermasers in
which...
What is
supermaser?
It's a maser, but huge.
Big maser.
Big maser. Huge maser, yeah. Spontaneous, because there is no spontaneous radiation. It is not engineered, therefore it shines when it wants to shine. There are similar objects with supermasers in which the rotation law is somehow not specified. People don't know how to fit it. So this NGC 47, NGC 4258, the rotation law omega naught is a very good approximation. It's an approximation up to 1%. But there are similar objects, two or three of them, with supermasers, in which it's difficult to find any rotation law that would fit. And now, the question is whether the quality of observation is not good enough, or maybe the general relativistic effects, which would just confuse the picture. Thank you very much.
What is rather frustrating is this arbitrariness. One would think that if you have a given physical system, then there's no freedom to choose a particular form that this will rotate in a certain well-defined way.
Okay.
If you have partial differential equations, many solutions.
But we are not talking about equations, we are talking about systems.
Yeah. We have a system, a ball of fluid, and this ball of fluid should not allow for choosing arbitrarily the...
There is a resolution. Assume that we have a ball of fluid at a given time t equals 0 with some dynamics, then you would have to allow friction, heat, and so on, and then that evolves, and if that ends in a stationary axially symmetric system, then it has to be such that this omega, angular velocity omega, will be, I don't know, Kaplerian or anything. But it will be arbitrary function from of a descent from
it will be determined by this evolution, not
it will be determined by the initial data.
Sure.
Plus this true, fiction, but you cannot say when you determine that equals zero, you don't know what will be the final angular velocity. You don't know that. You have to do the full evolution, then you discover. And from the point of view, from our point of view, we have a point of view.
In other words, it's a result of relaxations, and those are not very well known.
Well, but this is perfectly valid procedure to solve stationary solution equations. We do that all
yes,
the time.
But we risk that we will solve something which is not accessible in
But do you agree that Kepler rotation is okay?
The very concept that this is a stationary solution is wrong.
Yeah.
It will be a very long-lasting one.
But this is how the Schrödinger equation started. Isn't it so? From the stationary
heterogeneous. So many years
ago. But that's always the beginning.
Thank you.